right. Thank you very much to the organizers for the invitation. So my Electroweek tour today will start with Electroweek precision measurements. Then I will talk a little bit about anomalous gauge boson couplings. And in the end, time permitting, focus on one particular process that's relevant for that, which is high energy W pair production. So starting with the Electroweek precision measurements. These are, in general, any kind of measurements of observables which are measured so precisely that one would have sensitivity to whatever is running inside the loop. For instance, this could be a Higgs boson exchange, like in this example, or top quark exchange, like in this example over here, or it could be some loops of new physics particles. And some of the observables that are very relevant for this purpose are measured at the electroweak scale. This could be, for instance, the mass of the W boson, which, well, it's actually not measured at the electroweak scale, but it's electroweak scale parameter, but it's measured from the muon lifetime. And then various properties of the Z boson, for instance, the total width of the Z boson, which is seen here as the width of the line shape produced in the plus and minus. The peak cross section, which is basically the height of this curve here, and then the effective weak mixing angle, which is obtained from the left, right, and forward, backward asymmetries, and that effectively parameterizes the ratio of the coupling of the Z boson to left and right-handed fermions. But as we heard in the talk by Roger before the lunch break, there are also low energy measurements that are very important. And one way to say what these are measuring is to say they are measuring the weak mixing angle at low scales. Now, in order to have a scale-dependent weak mixing angle, the effective weak mixing angle is not suitable for that, but a better quantity to look at would be the MS bar mixing angle, because that has an undetermined scale in it. And the running of the scale is shown in this plot over here. So these are the Z-pole quantities that I just mentioned, and then there are various low-energy experiments. And they basically use a scattering of polarized electron-electron, electron-proton, or electron-deuteron scattering, as we heard. Or it could also be neutrino-nucleon scattering from NUTEF, as well as atomic parity measurements. Now, all of these quantities provide indirect evidence for heavy particles like Higgs, top, and so forth. Combining them with the direct measurements, one obtains a non-trivial correlation whether they agree or not. And this is seen here in this plot, which is a new update from the GFITTER collaboration, which will come out on the archive this week. In green are the direct measurements, here shown in the top quark mass on the x-axis and the W mass on the y-axis. And blue is the indirect determination from the various observables besides the W mass that I mentioned before. And the fact that they overlap is highly non-trivial at this level of precision. Actually, also interesting to point out, the light blue curves is what you would get before the determination of the Higgs mass. And we see, of course, that knowing the Higgs mass makes this overlap much more meaningful and less trivial. There are a number of quantities that go into this game, and they are shown on the right. This is a subset of them, as a matter of fact. I don't know if this is still visible. I think this is dying. And use the mouse pointer. So what this shows is the difference between the direct measurement shown by the error bar and the indirect determination from the precision observables by the blue bars. The orange is the combination of the two. And so overall, there's a pretty good agreement across the board. The global p-value is around 20%. But there are a few examples which stick out. This is most notably the forward-backward asymmetry for B quarks at LEP, and the left-right asymmetry at SLD. And I will come back to them a little later. Now, since many of these quantities are measured with sub-percent precision, in order to compare them theoretically, the theoretical predictions need to be equally precise at least, which means not just one loop, but two loop and even partial three loop corrections are necessary. A challenge here is, though, that starting at a two-loop level, in general, the loop integrals cannot be solved analytically anymore. And there are two general ways how to deal with that. One possibility is to try to find some expansion parameter. For instance, the top quark mass, which is the heaviest mass in the standard model, we can expand in inverse powers of that. Then the coefficients of that expansions will be simpler integrals. The alternative is to say we just attack the loop integrals numerically, straightforward, and there are a number of different ways how one can do that. All these methods have their advantages and disadvantages. In addition, we also could try to make practical choices. For instance, sometimes it's not necessary to compute all the loop diagrams, but for instance, for the electroweak two-loop corrections, it's often sufficient to just look at those that have fermionic closed subloops, like in these examples down here. Because there are many fermions in the standard model, that gives a natural enhancement by the multiplicity. And for those loops that have a top quark, they are also typically enhanced, partially at least, by the mass of the top quark. So here are a list of some of the most precisely measured quantities, W mass and various properties of the Z boson. All of them are measured with per mil level precision. But fortunately, we are in a situation that the theoretical precisions are even better than that, so that we are not limited by the theoretical uncertainty. Ooh. And this has become possible through the work of many, many people over many years. Now, for all these quantities, we have either complete two-loop or fermionic two-loop corrections, and even some partial three- and four-loop corrections. And I have to apologize, this list of references here is woefully incomplete. So there are many more people who contributed to this. Now, with this level of precision, one cannot only test the standard model, one can also put limits on future new physics, on new physics, physics beyond the standard model. One simple extension of the standard model, for instance, is the two Higgs doublet model. And shown here in the plot of the right is the constraints one gets from electroweak precision on the mixing angles of the Higgs bosons, alpha and beta for the CP even and CP odd Higgses. Another way to think about it is that this actually gives us a constraint on the coupling of the observed standard model like Higgs to vector bosons and fermions, shown over here. And the fact that the best fit is near pi over 2 basically tells us that these Higgs couplings can't be much different than from 1. Instead of a specific model, one can also try to put more model independent constraints in areas where we might expect to see big deviations if there's new physics. This is, for instance, the case for the gauge boson propagators. This is shown here in the bottom. These are the so-called oblique parameters, S, T, and U. So this plot on the right shows the constraints for S and T. The light ellipse is the expected, and the dark ellipse is the observed constraint from that. And again, we see that there's a reasonable agreement with the standard model, which is here in the center. Now, we are not observing any significant deviation yet, but of course, with increased precision, something might show up in the future. And where do we get this increased precision from? One source could be the LHC. It will improve the uncertainty somewhat, in particular for the W boson mass, will bring down to 8 MeV or even better than that. And as we also heard, it will provide an independent check, non-trivial check on the effective weak mixing angle. But the real dramatic improvement will be achieved with a future E plus E minus collider. Could be ILC or it could be FCC, any kind of high luminosity E plus E minus collider that runs at electroweak scale energies near the Z pole and W threshold. And in that case, some of the quantities will be measured with really impressively higher uncertainty, in particular down here in the table, the last line, effective weak mixing angle we expect will be improved by more than an order of magnitude. This is also shown in this plot on the right, again from the GFITA collaboration. The blue is the current uncertainties, green what we could get from future LHC and Tevatron data, and the orange is what the E plus E minus collider could give us. And if all the central values stay as they are, then some discrepancy could show up. Now, for the theorist, this will be a challenge, because actually at that point, we will have an experimental precision that exceeds the theoretical precision, which means we have to work harder. So probably three-loop electroweak corrections will be necessary, at least the fermionic ones. We cannot do that today, but hopefully we'll get that at some point. And interestingly, if we do, at that point, the theoretical precisions will be limited not by loop corrections, but just by the parameters that go into them. In particular, one that may be really hard to beat down in the long run is the shift of the electromagnetic coupling, going from zero to the Z mass, because that is really hard to obtain. One needs a lot of data from that at low energies. So the ILC though is not there today. So coming back to the LHC, I mentioned that it will provide an independent check of the effective weak mixing angle for measuring the forward-backward asymmetry in Drell-Jahn. And this might help resolve us this embarrassing discrepancy that we have between LAP and SLD over here. Quickly mention, although Jeff mentioned it in passing, how do we actually measure a forward-backward asymmetry at the LHC when the initial state is symmetric? What one takes advantage of is the fact that the quark is typically a valence quark, therefore has a higher momentum fraction than the anti-quark. So whichever direction the whole event is boosted in is declared to be the forward direction, the other one is the backward direction, and then one just looks whether the positive or negatively charged lepton goes preferred in one or the other way. So ATLAS and CMS have done that. There are also equivalent, even more precise measurements from the Tevatron. None of them is quite reaching the LAP and SLD precision yet, but there will be future improvements and they will come pretty close. And at that level of precision, we also have to ask again, do we understand it theoretically at that accuracy? There has been a lot of work going into predicting Drell-Jahn prediction with high precision. So we have next to leading order QCD corrections, and this plot shows the dramatic improvement in the uncertainties going from leading order in blue to next to leading order in red. If we also want to be sensitive to the PT, one has to resum QCD corrections. These are known to next to leading log, and also next to leading order electroweak corrections are known. But there may still be challenges out there that need to be tackled. For instance, multiphoton radiation in a final state could be important because the photons, when they are emitted from the leptons, kick the leptons around, and something that from the ZDK was originally going in the forward direction might end up going in the backward direction. So that's important to model correctly. Another potential thing that's not included yet are mixed QCD electroweak corrections. So these are examples where we might have gluons, meaning jets, radiated in the initial state, and photons radiated in the final state. This is actually work in progress by this collaboration over here. They don't have results for the Z yet, but they have some results for the W, shown here in this plot. And it shows that the correct treatment in red does actually differ from a naive treatment, shown in blue, where one takes this initial and final state radiation independent from each other. So that's not the correct thing to do. And then, of course, as Jeff mentioned, what we really need to also be able to handle are PDF uncertainties. They will be very important, especially at the LHC, where we have the symmetric initial state. So moving on to anomalous gauge boson couplings. So this is a recent observation of anomalous triple coupling from a facility in Brazil. But I will talk about LHC right here. And let me focus right now on triple couplings between W bosons and either a photon or Z boson. And I will furthermore focus on only the CP-even interactions. So one way to describe them is by this interaction Lagrangian here, which has in total six parameters, three for photon, three for the Z boson. The first one actually supposed to be one because of electromagnetic gauge invariance, which leaves five. But at that level, we still don't preserve the weak SU2 gauge interactions. So these interactions each by themselves are gauge violating. And there are additional problems with this formulation of the anomalous gauge boson couplings. For instance, these six terms that are in this Lagrangian are not the only ones one can write down. For instance, one could also have some, like this example over here, that involve additional derivatives. And there's no rule that tells us why we shouldn't include that. Even among the six terms that are in this formula, it's not clear which ones of those are leading or not leading, or are they all of the same order of magnitude. So an additional formulation that helps us get a better handle of these things would be using an effective field theory. So here, one writes down the new interactions as higher dimensional operators. And in order to match the overall dimension, the dimension 4 of the Lagrangian, they need to have some kind of scale lambda in the denominator, which typically is interpreted as the mass of some new particles. And it's assumed that this mass is so high that it's beyond the reach of our experiment. So it's a valid description for energies below the scale lambda. And in that case, the operators are naturally ranked in importance by how many powers of lambda they have in the denominator. And there's also simple prescriptions of what operators we should write down. It's basically all operators with the same dimensions that are allowed by all the gauge symmetries of the standard model. So for the anomalous gauge boson couplings, the CP even ones, the leading contributions comes in at dimension 6, and there are three possibilities shown down here, which means in this prescription we only have three independent parameters, not five, like in the other one. Nevertheless, both descriptions, of course, describe the same phenomenology. So there is a relation between them which one can actually compute, which is shown up here. So I can compute all the five parameters of the anomalous couplings from the effective field theory. And of course, it means they are interdependent. And down here, I show an illustration of the different ways to think about the situation. So the left diagram shows the picture with the anomalous couplings, where we have some gauge invariance violating interactions between two W's and a Z. The effective field theory knows about the gauge invariance violation, and it basically takes care of it by also including the Higgs field, and the vacuum expectation values of the Higgs field basically restore the gauge invariance. So this is therefore a better description for low energies. If we go to high energies, this description will also break down. At that point, we would expect that instead of a fundamental coupling here, we instead have some loop of some heavy particle, like a heavy fermion, with a mass that's comparable to the scale lambda. Now, at the LHC, of course, we are probing a lot of energies at the same time. There are high energy tails in every observable, and we might worry that we run into a situation where the effective field theory breaks down in those tails because we are probing the scale lambda. For sufficiently precisely measured observables, that's not a major concern, though, as long as we are still in the business of setting limits. Let me just show this example that we have seen also in Jeff's talk. This is the PT of the leading lepton in WW production. And let's assume, for the sake of argument, that we try to test the scale lambda, which would lead to violations of the effective field theory just here at the end of this tail. But the point is, such a low scale of lambda would already lead to new physics that would show up further down in this distribution over here. So we would have seen that already. The fact that we didn't see something in bins where we do have statistics means the scale of lambda is higher, and therefore setting a limit is still meaningful. So we can take these results here for the various anomalous couplings, and one could translate them into the scale of the effective operators, assuming order one couplings. So this is what comes out here on the right. Typically, a few hundred GeV is the new physics that we are probing. I should emphasize, though, that this table is just something that I made. It would be nice, of course, to have a proper experimental evaluation, which gives more reliable numbers. Now, I don't have much to say, or not much time to say something about quartic couplings. One thing I want to point out, though, is that these operators that I already mentioned for the triple couplings, they also do lead to quartic couplings at the same time. So this will be typically the leading effect. But in addition, there will be also dimension 8 operators that generate additional quartic couplings. Like one example down here, these are all operators that would contribute, for instance, to 4W couplings. But one would expect the dimension 6 operators normally to dominate. Also at dimension 8, actually, for the first time, we get interactions purely between neutral gauge bosons, photons and Zs. Even the triple couplings only come in at that order, and one would typically expect them to be smaller than in most new physics models. One can also use an effective field theory actually for studying new physics in the electroweak precision observables that I mentioned earlier. There's some other operators that are relevant for this. For instance, there are some that modify the Z boson propagator. There's some that modify the coupling of the Z boson to fermions. And the electroweak precision test put very strong constraints on them. So in this paper, for instance, the whole list of them has been evaluated one by one, and typically the scales that we are probing through them are on the order of 10 TeV. So electroweak precision tests are really very sensitive. But coming back at the end to W pair production, I don't mean Williams pair, but W boson pair. So this is one of the sensitive processes for testing anomalous gauge boson couplings. There are a couple others, you know, like other diboson production channels, and much of what I'm going to say here applies to them too, so I'm just focusing on this one example. And there are a number of theoretical complications with this, though. One thing is that W pair production can proceed either through QQ bar initial state, which is sensitive to this triple coupling here, ZWW or photon WW. But there can be also something that's induced by photons in the initial state, which is sensitive to this quartic coupling. Normally, one would get both of them, although CMS has actually shown us that to a certain degree, they can be experimentally distinguished. So that's already great. But even if we just consider the QQ bar part, that one is tricky to predict because it gets very large corrections from various sources. There are QCD corrections, which amount up to 50%. This is shown here by this pink curve, and I should emphasize that curve is divided by 10, otherwise it wouldn't fit on this plot. But they have been computed to next to leading order and also with some reformations, and it's estimated that we now understand that to a few percent level, so that's pretty good. As a matter of fact, though, even electroweak corrections, which are normally suppressed, may be very important. And the reason for that is that they may be enhanced, or are, in general, enhanced by logarithms of the scattering energy divided by the W mass. And I'm sorry, the squared should be in the denominator, of course. These logarithms can be large in the tails of the distributions, for instance, for high PT of the W. Up to 40 or 50%, which is shown by this red curve here. So they are very important. But they have been calculated, not only the leading, but the next to leading logarithms, and definitely should be included for testing these anomalous couplings. And why it's really important to include it, let me just illustrate, as Jeff already mentioned, and there was some question about it. We have already since a year or two this excess in the total cross-section of W pair production at a level of 2 sigma. And you know, if such an excess is sitting around, theorists like me become bored and they think this is supersymmetry. So for instance, several people have successfully fit this excess using Chargino's leptons or stops as potential explanations. And who knows, they might well be right, but of course, we need to make sure that we have all the different theoretical uncertainties under control in the comparison of experiment and theory, which means experimental systematics, higher order corrections, and also things like that have to do with how exactly the signatures selected, if they're jet vetoes, if they're photon vetoes, and stuff like that. So that brings me to my conclusions. So, electroweak precision tests, as well as high-energy vector boson pair production, are very interesting and very sensitive probes for new physics. They probe physics at a TeV scale. Sometimes it's scales that are beyond what we can access through direct searches. But of course, to make them meaningful, we need to have higher order radiative corrections in all the theoretical predictions. And a lot of work has gone into this and still needs to go into this in the future. In order to describe deviations from the standard model, effective field theories seem to be the most generic tool that one can use for that. It's well defined, and it can be used for all kinds of different physics, like the electric precision data, anomalous gauge boson couplings, as well as Higgs physics, which I didn't talk about, but Christoph did earlier. What should be pointed out is not only that understanding the electric theory theoretically is important for interpreting this, but also understanding the QCD, because at the LHC, QCD is always folded in with everything we observe. So we need to have QCD radiative corrections, we need to have QCD resummation, jet physics, all that stuff under control. And as big of a challenge and as great of an excitement as this at the LHC, a future E plus E minus collider will still lead us to a totally different level and probe things at a much deeper level. And who knows, maybe if we drill deep enough, something might show up. Thank you.
Thanks a lot for this tour. Completed again in time, so we do have again time for questions. This is going very well. Sorry.
I'm not sure that I understood your comment about multiple photon radiation in the Ralyan, because this is what we have included since ages. Why do you think there's a challenge still?
If I note correctly, I think you have included it through parton showers, is that correct?
No, we have at leptons. Our leptons are fully QED FSR corrected with multiple photon radiation.
Like how many photons, up to how many
up
photons?
Up to six photons, up to the exponentiation you have. We have even different Monte Carlos.
No, you definitely don't have six photon radiation with full matrix elements.
But then you have to be a little bit more precise that you have the first full matrix element in, we have
the second
matrix element which we can cross-check, and then we can have the radiation, but all additional photons we have in the leading contribution. So
yes,
I think your comment was quite
I should have explained it maybe a little bit more. I mean, the soft and collinear part of God is in, but what I mean is would be the hard radiation. And although in principle one would of course expect that to be much suppressed, but at the level of precision we might eventually reach, this is probably something one still needs to check, because it has been somewhat relevant at lab.
But this is now pursued, that it is checked for the second order matrix element.
This is not my idea for the first time, not at all. I know that
there's work ongoing, exactly.
Yes, for sure.
Any additional? I need a telescope.
You have mentioned that the production of W bosons can be divided between gamma-gamma scattering and coming from quark-quark-quark. How much is from one channel, the branching ratios between one channel and another one? And another thing is that could be possible distinguishing the polarization of W's experimentally?
Sorry, I didn't hear the second part of the question. Could you repeat that?
Yes. Is the polarization of the W's could be distinguished?
Okay, so to answer the first question, that depends somewhat on the energy. So here shown as a PT of the W bosons. So for low PT, the gamma-gamma contribution is suppressed by more than one order of magnitude, almost two orders of magnitude. For high PT, however, it grows faster than the other contributions, or falls off more slowly, I should rather say. And it becomes more important at that point. And that's, of course, the region where we are most sensitive up here at high energies. We are most sensitive to the anomalous couplings. So there it becomes actually more important. Now you ask about polarization. Yes, polarization of the W bosons give us additional handles for distinguishing the different couplings. So these are very important, and these are, I understand, already included for extracting some of the limits. So one, by looking basically at the angular distribution of the decay products, that gives us additional sensitivity.
Thank you. I think we have to move on. So let's thank the speaker again.